Good morning, everyone. Welcome. Glad to have you at Shade Tree Community Church, Facebook Online Live. You'll notice that I'm wearing a tie today, and there's one of three Sundays that I wear a tie: Christmas, Easter, and Mother's Day. So happy Mother's Day to all the ladies out there. We're glad that you can be with us here today. I want to remind you of just a couple of things, and then we're going to get started with our service. First of all, I want to thank you for your continued support of the ministry at Shade Tree. When we're apart from each other like this, sometimes it's easy to forget that the ongoing needs of the ministry continue week to week, and you have been so faithful in your continued support of Shade Tree's ministry, even while we are in self-isolation. If you would like to continue to support the ministry here, I encourage you to go to our website, shadetreecc.org. You'll find a donate button there on the front page. Or you can look at our liturgy that I email out, and it has the address for Mark Booz on East 330th Street in Willowick. And again, thank you so very much for doing that. We are also doing a midweek Wednesday night Zoom Bible study. And we are looking at some continued sub-themes in the Book of Lamentations. That's a series that we're in, except today. Each Sunday, we've been looking at a chapter in the Book of Lamentations. We're going to take a break with that this morning. We're going to talk a little bit about women in the Bible and the important role that they play in the world. So join us this coming Wednesday night. We'll take a look at the Book of Lamentations for a few moments, and you can, on that liturgy, find zoom.us. You'll find an ID and a password that you can get in and join us. We had a great time this past Wednesday night dialoguing a little bit about chapter one of Lamentations. I also want to remind you that in a few moments we're going to be taking communion together. So if you haven't put together your bread and your cup, you can do that as we get started. And I'd like to, at this time, turn it over to Corey and Jen, and they are going to read some scripture as a call to worship. May God bless you. May you be richly blessed by the service here today.
Call to worship. This is Psalm 34, 1 through 8. I will bless the Lord at all times.
The praise of God shall ever be in my mouth.
I will glory in the Lord.
Let the lowly hear and rejoice.
Proclaim with me the greatness of the Lord.
Let us exalt God's name together.
I sought the Lord, who answered me
and delivered me from all my terrors.
Look upon the Lord and be radiant,
and let not your faces be ashamed.
I called in my affliction, and the Lord heard me
and save me from all my troubles.
The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear the Lord and delivers them.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are they who take refuge in God.
Please join me in our opening prayer. Lord our God, we give thanks for the witness of bold women. In early times, today and into the future, bold women show us how to live as God's beloved children in God's beloved creation. God of tender care, like a mother, you never forget your children, and you know already what we need. In all our anxiety, give us trusting and faithful hearts, that in confidence and boldness we may embody the peace and justice of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. Is your breath in our lungs?
Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Today, I'd like to spend some time in prayer. I've written this prayer out so you can say it with me. It's fairly lengthy, but you'll notice in this prayer, we are celebrating women all around the world who played a significant role in God's work. God, our Creator, You made us in your image, and you call us from wherever we are in time and place to be your disciples. God of generations, we celebrate the lives of the women who fought the good fight and stood up for the gospel and the truth of Scripture yesterday and today. Strengthen our voice of proclamation. God of life, we give thanks for the bold women among us today who serve with a sense of purpose in their vocations as daughters, mothers, grandmothers, sisters, friends, and leaders. Empower us by faith and bless our vocations at home, in the church, and in the workplace. Inspire us to encourage one another in fellowship, laughter, partnership, and service. Loving God, we pray for the men throughout the ages who support and encourage women in their quest to use their God-given gifts for your purposes. Give us the courage to work together as equals to proclaim your grace and hope. O God, our greatest friend, surround us with your love and affirmation through the kindness of others, be they friend or stranger, young or old. Give us eyes to see the love you lavish on all people. God of understanding, give us courage to stand up for the abused, the needy, the sick, the poor, and the stranger. We pray for those who suffer in mind, body, or spirit, that you might bring healing and comfort. Inspire us to be your hands to provide for those in need as we are able. Holy God of the universe, throughout history, you have given us the courage to form and reform your church against all odds and into paths as yet unknown. By your Spirit and in unexpected ways, you have brought us to this place in the circle of your love. Guide our ways that we may grow in faith and hope. Make us your bold and faithful servants this day and forevermore through Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen.
Still in darkness, who all is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is a filling love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. Be set free. Oh, Jesus, I'm thankful for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes me walk back? A son and daughter. You.
Scripture, Ruth 1, 16 through 17. But Ruth replied, "Don't urge me to leave you or to turn back from you. Where you go, I will go, and where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if anything but death separates you and me."
Thank you so much, Jenny and Corey. We appreciate you leading us in worship this morning. Well, I debated earlier in the week about whether I should continue our series in the Book of Lamentations in this series entitled Collapse. But since it is Mother's Day, I think that it is important to take a break from lamenting, and we need to celebrate the women in our life. However, what's interesting about Mother's Day is part of my experience in the past, sitting under different ministers at different times on Mother's Day, sometimes women come into a congregation on Mother's Day and they're expecting to be uplifted, and somehow, because the preacher sees that as an opportunity to try to either encourage or chastise women for what they're doing, sometimes women exit out of the church feeling down about who they are. And so that's why I entitled my message today, Celebrating Women, Not Just Moms. You see, I could get myself in a lot of trouble with this topic here if I really put my hand to it, but I'm not going to. I am not going to make any comments about where you are in your station in life. It's important that we celebrate who you are right where you are. There are ladies sometimes that might feel sorrowful because they have not been able to have kids, and so this brings them a time of sadness. There might be some that are grieving because they have lost a child. There might be some that are angry because they've had a bad relationship with their mother. There might be those that are single and they find the topic is not real relevant at this stage in their lives. So there's all kinds of women that gather in public worship and online, and we are going to talk about. From Genesis through Judges, much of the storyline is dominated by male characters: Noah, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses, Joshua, Samson, and Gideon. And they are marked by greatness. But there's a brief mention of some of the women that accompany them, Sarah, Rebecca, Leah, Rachel, Miriam, and Rahab. But in the book of Ruth, we meet some ordinary people. These people are more like us, and they are simply trying to make a living. They are people that are living at a point in time where they're not going to perform miracles. They're not going to split the Red Sea in two. But what we find is a straightforward journey of these ladies and how they complement each other and they carry on the work of God in the world. The story is told pretty straightforward. It focuses on a family, a man by the name of Elimelech and his wife Naomi. Here's how it goes. In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a man from Bethlehem in Judah, together with his wife and two sons, went to live for a while in the country of Moab. They go to a foreign country. The man's name was Elimelech, the wife's name was Naomi, and the names of the two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem of Judah, and they went to Moab and they lived there. So they are going to move from their homeland to a new place. And there is a reason why they moved there. There was a famine that was going on in the land. And what we find taking place is this man, Elimelech, had to make a difficult decision to leave his homeland to take care of his family. This man goes into a foreign country. And it is there because he has lost his property. In light of the famine, it is there. He is trying to make a new way, make a new livelihood. But he goes into foreign territory, and while he is there, he has two boys. They marry two Moabite women, two foreign women, and their names are Ruth and Orpah. It says in verse 3, now Elimelech, Naomi's husband, though, dies, and she is left with only her two sons. They married Moabite women, one named Orpah and the other Ruth. And after they had lived there about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion also died, and Naomi was left without her two sons and her husband. So tragedy hits. If as the famine was not bad enough, they moved to Moab, they try to make a new life, the husband of Naomi passes away. So she makes a new life with her two sons, and they marry two women, and that is the core of their family. And they live there a total of 10 years. And then suddenly, and we're not told why, these two sons pass away. It might have been a pandemic, it may have been an epidemic, it may have been an act of violence, we don't know. And now you have three widows. And these three widows are left with nothing, as such is the case in the ancient Near East. But Naomi hears something, that God is starting to open up a way for his people back in their homeland of Bethlehem. There's a bit of irony there. They live in Bethlehem, which means the house of bread. They have to leave the house of bread because of a famine. And now it says that they can come back. It says in verse 6 here, when she had heard in Moab that the Lord had come to the aid of his people by providing food for them, Naomi and her daughter-in-laws prepared to return home from there. And with her two daughter-in-laws, she left the place where they had been living, and they set out on the road that would take them back to the land of Judah. So they take a proactive stance and says, we're going to have to move back, and we're going to have to make our way back to our homeland. Moab was no place for an Israelite widow to try to eke out a living, and so they make a decision to return, and it wasn't an easy one because her daughter-in-laws, Orpah and Ruth, have family there, and yet they, as we can see, choose to go back with Naomi, and they head out on the road. It says in verse 8, though, that while they are on the road, actually verse 7, with her two daughter-in-laws, she left the place where she had been living and set out on the road that would take them back to the land of Judah. So they're on the road, and as they're traveling back to Bethlehem, Naomi turns to her daughter-in-laws and says, go back, each of you, to your mother's home. May the Lord show kindness to you as you have shown to your dead, that is their husbands, and to me. May the Lord grant that each of you will find rest in the home of another husband. All of a sudden, Naomi comes to her senses and says, there's really nothing that I can offer you back in Bethlehem. You would have to meet someone and get married again. And then there's a little bit of comic relief in this story because she says to them, just go on back to your homeland in Moab, find another man, get married, settle down, have a family. In verse 11, it says, but Naomi said, return home, my daughters. Why would you come with me? Am I going to have any more sons who could become your husbands? Now think about this for a moment. She is saying, if you come with me, I'm not going to get pregnant again. I'm too old to get pregnant. And even if I could get pregnant and I had two boys, you're going to have to wait a long time before they're of marriageable age. And so there's a little bit of comic relief in this story. And so what she does is she makes this attempt for them to go back home. This final attempt, she says, return home, my daughters. I'm too old to have another husband. Even if I thought there was still hope for me, even if I had a husband tonight, then gave birth to sons, would you wait till they grew up? Would you remain unmarried for them? No, my daughters, it is more bitter for me than for you because the Lord's hand has gone out against me. So she begins to perceive that God is against her, which is a normal kind of mindset in that day. Think of the book of Job and other instances as well. But here is where this courage of a woman steps up. Her name is Ruth. They weep together, verse 14. And then Orpah decides to go back to her home in Moab. She kisses her mother-in-law and says goodbye to her. And then verse 15, it says, look, said Naomi, your sister-in-law is going back to her people and her gods. Go back with her. Join her on the journey. And then comes this famous verse out of the book of Ruth. Ruth replied, don't urge me to leave you or to turn back from you. Where you go, I will go. Where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people and your God, my God. And where you die, I will die. And there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if anything but death separates you and me. And when Naomi realized that Ruth was determined to go with her, she stopped urging her. There is such deep loyalty in the heart of Ruth that she does not give it a second thought. She says, no matter what you say, I'm going to return home with you. And Ruth, with this fierce determination, makes this speech that is full of pathos and emotion. And she makes a pledge that she's going to follow her mother-in-law back home. Now, realize there's nothing that's guaranteed when they get back there. Ruth sticks with her mother-in-law, even though as widows, both of them, they're poor. They have no prospects. They have no pension. They have no PPP. Nothing. Nothing. And as they get back there, they come into Bethlehem, verse 19. So the two women went on their way. They came to Bethlehem. When they arrived in Bethlehem, the whole town was stirred because of them. And the women exclaimed, can this be Naomi? 10 years has gone by, and there was a lot of winds of grief that swept across Naomi's face. She lost her husband. She lost her two sons. She is aged now. There's wrinkles there. There are grief lines that are there. And so Naomi turns to the people that begin to look and say, is that really you, Naomi? She says in verse 20, don't call me Naomi. Call me Mara. I have a name change here. Call me Mara, which means bitterness. Because the Lord Almighty has made my life very bitter. I went away full, but the Lord has brought me back empty. Why call me Naomi? The Lord's afflicted me. The Almighty brought misfortune upon me. So Naomi returned from Moab, accompanied by Ruth the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law, arriving in Bethlehem as the barley harvest was beginning. Doesn't look too promising, does it? Ah, but the barley harvest was beginning. Here is this woman, Naomi. Her name means pleasant and she changes it to bitterness. And now she comes to this point where she tells her daughter-in-law to go out into the barley harvest and to try to glean some things to make a living, to get some food for them. They were very fortunate that they lived under the law of the Torah, lived under the law of Moses at this time, because the law allowed for some gleaning for the poor. They would not harvest all the way to the edge of the field. They could take some of the grain that was there. And there's a new man that's introduced in the text. His name is Boaz, and he's a relative of Naomi, and he owns a field. And if you read the rest of the book, you'll find that he's going to make some provisions for Naomi and Ruth. He tells his workers, make sure you knock off some of that barley off the wagon so it falls to the ground so that Ruth could pick it up. What we find amazing in this is the story of two women, that one of them is full of bitterness and anger and heartache, but Ruth is full of devotion to her mother-in-law, and she goes out to pick grain, and Boaz takes notice of her. And now we find in the book of Ruth that Boaz has a legal obligation to help take care of this family. And so you can read the rest of the text, but it's called in the ancient Near East a kinsman redeemer, someone that will step in to rescue, someone that will help. And what we find taking place here is something absolutely profound and providential. It is something that God is doing even when we can't see what he is doing. He uses a faithful daughter-in-law, Ruth. She goes out. She does some hard work. The hard work is to bring some barley back so that they can make some bread and have a meal. But she meets a man by the name of Boaz, and Boaz takes it upon himself to care for them. And then Boaz does something really, really out of the box. He makes a choice that he's going to marry Ruth. And as he comes to take her hand in marriage, there's this huge setup that is taking place. For what we find is Boaz, as he redeems this family from all the heartache that could come upon them as they move back into their homeland, he takes it upon himself to take care of these individuals. And as Boaz hears her story, he falls in love with Ruth and they get married. And here's where the story takes a turn. Ruth becomes the great grandmother of King David. And she's a foreigner. She's a Moabite. Now, let me bring it all together. I've just told you the story. You have three different women in chapter one. These three different types of women have something in common. They're all widows. But they have some different priorities in their lives. Naomi is obsessed with the past. She's full of pain, and she even changes her name. Orpah, though, seems to be concerned about the future. And so she realizes that there's nothing for her back in Bethlehem, and she will go back to her own people and try to make a new life. Ruth is concentrated on the present. She's concerned about her mother-in-law. She is present in the moment with the promise of emotion and devotion. Here's the story. The Bible tells us about women in all three stages of life, the past, the present, and the hope for the future. And wherever you are today, ladies, we celebrate you. Whether you're still trying to outrun some of the things that happened to you in your past, there is a kinsman redeemer that is a part of the lineage of this woman, Ruth. His name is Jesus. And Ruth becomes a part of this Davidic line that will produce the Messiah, Jesus, who is willing to continue to help and heal. He is one that is willing to redeem us and bring wholeness to us. We celebrate you, even if you're carrying some burdens on your back. And we're here to pray for you and help you and to love you. We celebrate you if your concern is about tomorrow, like Orpah. You're concerned about the bend in the road. Where are we going and where is this pandemic taking us? Am I going to be able to retain my job? Am I going to be able to make ends meet? God is already out ahead of you around the curve. God is there and he knows what you need. And we know at times what you need, if you'll tell us, to try to help in that as you face the future. But here is Ruth, concentrated on the present. She's in concern about her mother-in-law. She is present in this moment of time to help her mother-in-law, to love her mother-in-law, to work on behalf of her mother-in-law. Isn't this an amazing story? That we can celebrate women who have had it tough, women who are concerned about what's coming up down the line, and women in the moment who take it upon themselves to love and to serve other people. So we celebrate women in all walks of life this morning. We are celebrating women, not just mothers, today. Some of you are mothers. We are thankful for you and we celebrate you. Some of you are wives. You have no children, but we celebrate you. Some of you are single, and we celebrate you. Some of you are daughters, but not mothers, and we celebrate you. Some of you are partners to other women, and we celebrate you. Some of you are leaders. We celebrate you. Some of you are followers, and we celebrate you. These lessons will teach us about tomorrow. It'll teach us that things like we are going through right now come along. And we will need to be able to push past the pain of what will be the past. And we will also need to be present in the moment with the promises to be available for one another. And we will need to prepare for the potential of tomorrow. This story tells us a lot about our own wisdom. Are we pushing past the past? Are we present in the promise of the moment, and will we need to prepare? We will, for whatever comes tomorrow. So I want to close this morning by reminding you these stories are in the scripture for you to resonate with, no matter where they are in their life and no matter where you are in your life. These points obviously pay a big deal into our lives as men as well. We need to do the same thing, push past the past, to be present in the promise of the moment, and to prepare for tomorrow. Now, there is an interesting verse. This interesting verse is in chapter 2, verse 14, and we didn't get into chapter 2. But Boaz says to Ruth at mealtime, Boaz says, come over here, have some bread, and dip it into the wine vinegar. Theologians call this typology, that there are certain things that are reflected in certain individuals in the Old Testament that become apparent in the life of Jesus as well. Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, pushes past his past, concentrates on the present, and gives a promise for tomorrow. And it's all at the Last Supper. And it is there that he will certainly allow us to enter into his story as a type of Boaz. Jesus Christ takes a piece of bread and wine and gives it to us. Yes, we are Ruth in the story. Yes, we are Naomi in the story. Yes, we are Orpah in the story. And yes, Jesus is Boaz in the story, our kinsman, redeemer. So if you will take your bread and your cup at this time, we're going to celebrate communion, and I'm going to invite those that are here, if they'd like to come up and get a piece of bread and a cup, to do so at this time. So let me pray, and then we'll take the bread and the cup. Heavenly Father, thank you that this story is full of promise and potential and healing balm for each and every one of us. Thank you for Jesus, our kinsman redeemer. We come and we thank you for the promises of life that are given through Jesus. We thank you for his body broken for us and thank you for the blood that was spilled out on our behalf. Thank you, Father God, that we can remember that this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. When Jesus was at the table with his disciples, he took a piece of bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's eat together in remembrance of the Lord. On the night that Jesus was betrayed by Judas, he took a cup that was filled with wine, and he held it up and he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." This new covenant is a covenant established in him and in his finished work. And so for many generations, people just like you and me, ordinary people, the Ruths and the Boaz and the Orpahs and the Naomis of the world, remember the goodness of the Lord. So let's take this cup and drink together. We're going to close this morning with a couple of closing comments. In your liturgy, there is a response. There's a bold section. I'm going to ask a question, and I'm going to ask Corey to kind of do your part by reading the bold. Who will be your people?
I will be a part of your people.
Where will you go?
Wherever God leads.
What are you willing to seek?
I will seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness.
So let us hear the good news. Wherever we are, there God is. We are never left alone, even in the most trying circumstances. We are never left alone, even in a strange land. We do have a kinsman redeemer. His name is Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Thank you for joining us online. God bless you. Have a wonderful day.